start with the really important stuff, which is your mustache real?
Yeah. Yeah. You can pull it if you like.
I can?
Yeah, go on.
Can I try?
Yep. Oh, yes, it is real.
Yeah.
So, you go around with this mustache all the time?
Well, actually, I tend to sort of grow the mustache. Fortunately, it grows incredibly quickly, so I can sort of whip one up ready for the next tour and stuff. But it tends to be a bit of a ritual on the last night of a tour that the mustache. It's a kind of magic. It's a kind of magic. No, I don't walk around like this at all. No, obviously not. I don't look anything like Freddie Mercury at all. And even after concerts, I can nip out, you know, and sort of, you know, work my way through a crowd and disappear. And no, people won't know it's me at all. So, which is terribly convenient. I think it's quite nice. So, no, I don't normally dress up at all like, you know, this. That would be, you know, probably certifiable. Yeah, no, it's tricky, is a short answer to your question. Damn tricky. But the longer you listen to Freddie's voice and the more you learn about how a voice works and how the registers, you move through registers and stuff, and you hear what he does, particularly, you know, live, you know, it was fantastic, but in the studio, unsurpassed. Yeah, I think he's got amazing, because a lot of people can sing high, but they've got a naturally high voice. They've got the register you can hear is quite high, like an Iron Maiden type voice that sort of goes and goes up, you know. Freddie had this sort of almost like a rich baritone style that still went high, you know. So you've got all that depth and resonance as well.
When you go on the stage in the concert, is it like improvisation for you, or do you do everything?
I think there are certain things that it's not always the same, and it's not. I think if it was always the same, you wouldn't be doing it right. I think a good example of that is that Queen, they filmed Montreal, I think they did sometime '81, and it was a fantastic, beautifully sort of like quality images and stuff, and it was great. But the director wanted it done over two nights, and he said to Freddie, "Right, I want you in the same costume changes and do the same moves, so I can cut." And Freddie just went, "Well, no, I don't do it that way," because you can see when Freddie Mercury performs, it's his. As I said before, there's an interaction with the audience, but you're transmitting that music and you're feeling that music in the moment and then giving it to that audience. And those combinations, you can spin that dial a million times, you'd have a different combination slightly each time. You need to sort of react to that in the moment each night. So, yes, there will be similarities between performances because, you know, there's going to be a crossover point between concerts and things, but it's not choreographed in that respect. You're having fun with it each night. And I think that's probably another reason why it stays fresh and feels fun. You don't think, right, now I do this, now I turn, and one, two, three, four, boom, and, you know, arms out. You know, it's not that at all.
So you yourself have never seen Queen live?
No, I wanted to. I saw them, I sat up with my mum in 1986, and it was a little Tyne-Tees production. And I'd wanted to go to that particular concert, because that was when I was about, I think I was 14, when those were dates were announced. And it just wasn't possible. It wasn't going to happen. I live miles away from London, or anywhere that they were touring. So, I thought, well, I'll be old enough to sort it all out myself, and I'll have a bank account and everything next time they tour. And there wasn't a next time, but of course nobody knew that at the time. University, when we got the news that Freddie was ill, and then immediately after the news that Freddie had died, and we'd never seen Queen live, but we'd always thought we would. We just wondered why they hadn't toured. So part of this was just sort of like try and write that somehow in a kind of very illogical kind of way. Let's try, and we didn't really think it through a great deal, but we thought, no, we've got to put this concert on. Tribute bands were only just beginning then.
When you guys started the band, did you have a competition who gets to do Freddie Mercury?
No, it all kind of came about. There's sort of two phases to it, really, because I was always singing up and down the corridors anyway, in the halls of residence we live. And I was always singing on top of my voice, screeching away. So it wasn't a huge shock that when I started doing Queen songs, and we all started playing Queen songs like wall to wall, like when Freddie died, and working out how it went. And because they're quite tricky things to work out, some of those chords and key changes and stuff. So we all sort of pulled, how does that one work? How does that one work? But it wasn't a massive surprise that, you know, I'll do the Freddie then, because it was kind of like, I was always the one singing. So, you know, once we realised that, oh yeah, we are going to form a tribute band, we flipped the switch and became quite focused about it, because we had to rehearse and we were terrified of making complete idiots of ourselves, dressed up as Queen. So, you know, with crazy wigs we bought from Brixton Market and stuff, and it was all, we didn't really know what we were doing, but we thought we'd try and you know, fail spectacularly, at least, you know. and we sort of landed on our feet, luckily. Just imagine all of this out here, with every single road to the back row filled, and every arm up in the sky, people jumping up and down, people screaming, you know, with excitement, and all clapping their hands to Radio Gaga. And you see this, and it's very, very good fun. Sometimes you sort of have to sort of pinch yourself slightly. But yeah, there it is again. That's so cool. I tell you what though, you can't stand next to these things for too long because your trousers do melt after a while. So, health and safety tip there for any budding Freddie Mercurys.
Has that actually happened to you?
Yes, it has actually. I have come unstuck slightly, or rather stuck. Yeah, you can't shake your tush too near an audience blinder.
Yeah, you've been Queen like almost longer than Queen were, you know, doing a band, right?
Blimey. Yeah, well, it's coming up to 20 years. Yeah. And they notched up sort of 20 years. They moved the dates around to get anniversaries in before Freddie died and things. But I think the parallels have to stop there because Queen were this enormous, huge, global thing. And we've done very well, but, you know, I wouldn't want to draw too many parallels with our illustrious 20-year career and their illustrious 20-year career.
But you've got some tired, don't
you? No, a lot of people ask that. I think it's reasonable to ask if you've been 20 years. Surely, you know, is it just going through the motions and stuff? And it's not, I think. It's like saying you get bored at Christmas, you always open presents. Every year, you always open presents under the same tree. You know, do you ever get bored of that? I go, no, it's brilliant. They're presents, for God's sake. This is fun, you know. No, I wouldn't want to change it.
How much money can you make with this kind of stuff?
You can have quite a nice life doing it, yeah. I don't think you're going to get anywhere. I don't think there's very many millionaire tribute artists knocking around. So before anyone gets their CVs out, I think, right, this will be the career for me. It's, you know, it's a lot of hard work and, you know, we didn't get here, you know, in terms of, you know, playing the arenas and standing there overnight. It took a long time and a lot of sorting out. You can have an okay living. If you're looking to become a millionaire overnight, you know, go to law school or something, you know, have a proper job. Don't stand burning your trousers near park ends. That's not the most sensible way to do things.